Monday. We're coming to you live right here from inside the main build facility at Bubba's Exotic Motorsports. I'm Tom. The ladies man's been getting out there, sitting down there, getting a suntan. He knows we're talking about him. He stopped panning there. And we all know the master, Bub. Good morning, Bub. How are we doing today?
Doing pretty good so far, man. Just working away. It is 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time. We have been getting a lot of stuff done here already at BEM. A lot of crazy rides here. A lot of the player rides are here. We are wrapping up for spring training. So we are finishing up some of those high-end rides, a lot of the modern performance, and also one of the older projects that we've had here at BEM for quite some time. This 54C3100 that has been now converted over to a Chevrolet S10 chassis for a lot of great upgrades.
Been a long, long, long month and a half, hasn't it,
Bob? Yep.
20 hours a day, around the clock, getting this stuff done with all the media contracts and everything else going on. Long month and a half. Good morning, Larry Williams out there. Larry's got a couple of Dodge Challengers that are sent in. They're going to be doing some movie work with it. They chop the tops on them and stuff like that. Congratulations to him over there. That's why BEM will only partner up with them. Bubba's Exotic Motorsports is a sponsor of this show, of course. Bub, top of the hour here. Bubba's Exotic Motorsports.com. 20,000 new parts online. Visit us, and we'll be carrying all of the code 504 parts as well. Miss Outlaw Boutique, MS Outlaw Boutique. The moose is loose. I think the girls are closed today down in Abacoa. 561-660-6695. Beautiful Robin's out in Tampa, away for a couple of days. The beautiful Layla's right here, and you're going to be in Tampa next weekend, Bub.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that. We got to figure out that schedule.
Oh, really?
Moving on.
Okay, right on, man. So a lot of travel time going on as well.
Yep.
So, Bub, we're going to jump right in here. We're going to talk about this 54 Chevy BEM code 504 Chevrolet pickup that we've been building. A lot had to be done on this vehicle, as you know. And, Bub, good morning to Keith McKenzie Woodward out there at Code 504 as well. How are you? They joined us on Saturday, Bub, on the number one rated internationally syndicated motorsports podcast, and we talk about this build, Bub.
Yeah.
Let's talk about where we are today versus where we were Saturday.
Yeah, it's, since I didn't work all the way through the weekend, right?
Yeah.
So as of this morning, so everything has been completely fitted to the S10 chassis. As you can see, the front clip is on, the cab is on, the box, the bed is on. All of that has already been assembled. I am down to now my final alignments. Everything is snugged in place. The body and front end are all in place, secured and tightened. The box is now in place and tightened down. Now I'm down to my final adjustments in terms of the height of the cab versus the angle of the bed. So that's my next step here after this show. We're gonna get that done. And then once that is all completed, we'll go ahead and start getting on the front and the rear bumpers. All those brackets are already sitting ready in place. So it is literally a matter of just final assembly, and then we can move into those next steps.
And Bub, a couple of the things you've encountered on this, a lot of people think you can just snap your fingers and these things are done in no time at all. Somebody over the course of the lifetime of this vehicle welded the rear bed mounting location on the bed itself to a different area, which threw the factory fit of the Code 504 kit off, and you had to make some pretty big modifications back there.
Yeah, that was on the left rear corner of the bed. Was, of course, you know, just going through, you know, anytime you start working with these older cars, again, man, it looks like, you know, from what the people are told and old numbers matching, and it's never been painted, it's never over 50, 60 plus years of a vehicle.
Something
gets changed, modified, altered in some sort of way, and it happens on probably 90%, 95% of all these older cars out there. A true survivor is very rare and limited anymore in today's world. But I'll tell you what, man, this is just that case. This one's supposedly on factory paint. You get back to the rear of the bed and the entire left rear bed rail has been completely cut off, and it's had, you know, clumps of welding wire all over the thing, and freaking popcorn welding all over the place, and the cab corners have mesh of Bondo all over them and fiberglass. And so it's never, ever the case that you are working with something that has original paint because it's faded like this.
That's exactly right.
And it looks like it's old.
That's exactly
not at
right.
all.
So, Bub, what other alignment problems did you have with the bed of this or the Code 504 BEM bed go on pretty good, man?
No. So, you know, as we mentioned on Saturday, also last week, you know, going into, you know, discussing the cab about it, discussing the quality of the parts from Code 504, everything has been truly like bolt on as it should in terms of take it out of the box, you know, understand what you're supposed to do with it, line it up, drill your holes, mark your marks. You know, you do all that stuff and everything has fit exactly how it should. The only time you run into issues is, again, like what I just mentioned, you know, there were five of the six bed mounts were all in the exact location. Every bushing fell in right in place, but then that last one, the left rear, and of course, before you tighten anything down, you want to get all your hardware started and, you know, it's just snugged in a little bit. Then you can make your modifications and alignment from there, left to right, front to rear. You know, you can modify everything from there if you need to, but that left rear bed corner, or the left rear bed corner was already modified at some point. So it was a good inch and a half off from where it should have been, from where they welded on some extra tabs and like moved this little box corner in a little bit. So a little bit of work there this morning, but it's done, it's on. Now I'm literally just at that final piece of, I'm actually gonna raise the rear of the cab up so that the body angle, which is right here, the body angle at the door, I actually want to bring it up. If, you know, not really people can see from just the video itself, but the cab is sitting lower in the rear. So I'm going to bump that up, get that angle sitting right, finish getting the running boards on, and then I'll be down to, you know, undercoating, getting everything textured, getting all of the engine bay done, mask it up, do a 40 grit through there, do all the Rhino lining everywhere, and this thing will be ready for its powertrain.
So Bub, what, let me ask you a question. Why is the back end of this truck sagging? And not sitting even with the front end of the truck. This was an S10 frame. We bought an S10 and chopped it up and put it underneath of this vehicle. So why is there a difference in the front and rear ride height?
So right now, actually, the S10 that we had gotten was a donor chassis, 118-inch wheelbase, exactly what it should be, which is the long bed, short cab. So we did get the exact setup that we needed. It was a factory 4.3. So doing the V8 conversion in it is going to be very, very easy. Literally just a matter of brackets from code 504. You tell them exactly what motor you're running. You buy the bracket kit. They're already installed. Motor and transmission mounts are already ready to go. So after I'm done doing this engine bay and it is beautiful, ready to go, I'm going to just simply drop the motor and transmission in this thing and have this thing ready to get all of its final drivetrain hooked up. But I'll tell you what, as we got the donor, it actually was a 3-inch rear drop kit in this thing. But the guy never finished a job, right? So he bought parts to do the front, the springs and the spindles, which were with the truck. So he bought the springs, spindles for the front and also rear blocks for the rear to drop this thing down really nice when it was previously an S10. So that kit would still actually be beautiful on this 54 cab. It would literally fill in from the fender well, 6 o'clock, to the tire, 12 o'clock. You've got about 4 inches there, so you could do a nice, you know, Beltec sit, you know, whatever you want to do, but you can do a full spring and spindle combo in the front to drop this thing down 3, 3.5, get it nice and tucked to the ground. The rear is already sitting at the 3 drop, and it'll still keep it fully functional to where you won't be bottoming out. You won't even have to do C-notches now with the way you've got clearance on this new code 504 on the rear chassis.
So where you say there's a C-notch, what happens, what is a C-notch? What does that do for the vehicle?
So it actually gives you more room for the axle to travel up and down inside of the factory rear chassis without bottoming out.
And that requires modification?
Yeah, that's cutting the chassis in half, yeah.
Look like a C or something?
Yeah, it sort of looks like a C. And to here, if you wanted to do it on this even more, you could very easily do it because now you've got even more room from the top of the chassis, the S10 frame, to the bottom of the bed with the extension of the brackets in between from code 504. So you could simply just put on your C-frame C-notch, put it on, you can mark it, mount it, then you could go through the center of it and just cut it out with a plasma cutter and put in your center plate and it would be done and you wouldn't have no chassis flex or anything.
Does that create any kind of instability or chassis compromise?
Nope,
at all?
Not at all.
None? Now what happens, Bub? One of the things that we recognized here is that good morning to Tom and Bub from McKenzie Woodward. Good morning, McKenzie, from code 504. This is the BEM code 504 Chevy S10 C3100 conversion, ladies and gentlemen. A big show Saturday. Tons and tons of people watch that show, Bub. Tons and tons of people commenting. It's still getting comments right now today. I was looking at them, Bub, from the Saturday podcast. But one of the things with the back end sitting lower because of the modifications that were done to the suspension with lowering blocks, right? It created a problem for you with the wheel and tire combination. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about what was happening there.
Yeah, so currently as it's sitting, when you have for right now, we're still working with the true S10 chassis on the 54 C3100 bed, sure. Taking, you know, everything here. So what you're working with is a bed that is the inner wheel tubs of the bed were a little bit wider than the S10 chassis, right? So they overhang on the left and right sides, the S10 frame rails, because the S10 was a little bit narrower of a truck. So what now you're working with is when you do these kinds of swaps, as you can see, there's a lot of clearance between flush of the fender well and the inner portion because the S10 chassis was such a narrower wheelbase. There are many ways around that. You could either A, do something very simple like 2.5-inch billet wheel spacers. You can bolt them on 5x4¾ lug pattern. You can bolt them on. It will bump that wheel out and it'll be perfect fit if you want to stay with the S10 style wheel. Or you can have a complete custom set of wheels built for the truck. That would give you a really massive setup with a super deep dish. A lot of guys like that look. Or you can do a combo of both. You can stay with, you know, a 7 or 8 inch wide wheel and still run a different set of spacers to bump everything out so that it sits flush. Yeah, you could, you know, you can have plenty of options to set up a wheel and tire combo, but you want to make sure before you do the wheel and tire side of it, always have your stance sitting where you want it with all of the vehicle weight in it. So the motor, the transmission, you want to make sure everything's in place from a weight factor, get it sitting where you want it, and then you can go ahead and modify from there.
So since the front end was not tampered with on the S10 chassis, but the rear end had lowering blocks on it, Bub, what way are you going to go? What is going to be the solution to raising that rear end back up again?
You know, right now it's kind of in the air. You know, it's I think with the actual goal of this project, the goal of it was to, you know, build just a very nice kind of a budget style build for this client, and you know, and that's why we chose to go with the S10 chassis, the code 504 conversion. There's so much you can do, and you can do it on almost a budget instead of buying like a $25,000 Art Morrison chassis where you literally lift the body up, you roll a new one underneath, and then you put the body back down. That gives you plenty of expansion for, you know, power, handling, performance, everything you could possibly imagine, structure, safety, but you're also looking at getting upwards of $40,000, $50,000, $60,000, $70,000 when you start doing builds that way, because you're looking at $20,000, $25,000 just to get a chassis under it. That's just a bare chassis. That's literally bare chassis with four-wheel disc brakes, with, you know, your independent suspension. So it's a really nice setup, but that's a rolling chassis. That's all you're getting for $20,000 to $25,000 before any labor goes into it. So figure $30,000, $32,000, you're looking at a rolling chassis setup with no powertrain. So then you start looking at LS motors starting at $5,000 to $10,000.
Yep.
Then you start looking at, you know, transmissions, and these are all brand new products. These aren't just going to a junkyard and buying, you know, a used LS1 and from a wrecked Camaro or Trans Am, whatever it may be. You know, so you're looking at, you know, builds that can go up and up and up and up and up, where you can do an S10 style conversion where all in your time and materials just for this conversion alone, you're $1,500. We bought this S10 donor for $1,500 there, $2,000 into the product from code 504. So even then you're still at $3,500, $4,000 just in material there before you even get into doing the labor side of it, which is, as you know, over a solid week's worth of time just to get that conversion done. And that's not even including, you know, taking the old S10 apart, the cab, the bed, getting rid of all that crap,
all the disassembly on
the
that
ABS
side.
Lines, the electronics, you know, because it is a newer chassis. So typically it's going to have airbags, it's going to have ABS, it's going to have a lot of different components, computers, wiring, I mean, all kinds of stuff you got to take off, strip this one down, so much stuff to get it ready.
Anything that people should know about when working with airbags in this kind of build, Bob?
I mean, you know, if you're working with something that already has airbags in it, you know, a newer S10, pretty much anything from 96 and newer is going to have something in it like that, maybe even earlier than that in some of them. But you want to make sure, just basics, man, disconnect the batteries. A lot of people say pull fuses. A lot of people say pull relays if you can. And then it's just being safe from there. You know, don't make sure, you know, don't reach in and pry on an airbag, right? Anything to set it off, it will go off. So you want to just make sure that you're simple and safe with it. Don't overthink the process. It's not like it's that dangerous. You just need to make sure that you're following the steps of disconnect the electrical, let it sit and drain down for a little bit. Some people go way overboard and they're like, you know, touch the positive and negative together to drain the resistors and the ECU. And, you know, okay, listen, just relax. Make sure you take it. Make sure you take it out safely and follow the instructions of how to remove an airbag. And it's that simple.
It's just not that tough, is it, Bub? So, Bub, what is the plan for today on a code 504 BEM conversion?
My plan for today is to finish my alignments. You know, as I mentioned at the start of the show, everything is in place. It is all bolted in. All mounting hardware is in place. Now it's a matter of my final tweaking, my final alignments. Getting the rear of the cab, I'm going to bring up. The bed is in place and locked in.
Sure.
So I'm going to bring up the rear of the cab, go ahead and finish mounting. The only other front bracket I have is right here at the very front for the grill. So I'll mount those in, and that should be it. Then I'd like to get the running boards in place, get those done, so I could officially have a full rolling chassis that's done and aligned today. Then I can start moving into my next step, which is undercoating textures, you know, looking into the paint side of it, and then I'll start laying in that beautiful powertrain.
I noticed, Bub, that you've got some areas that are grinded, are welded shut here. Tell us a little bit about what's going on with that on the firewall there.
Yeah, so this truck, you know, it was, for the most part, original when it came into us. There were a lot of, let's see, there were really no alterations to the truck. There was an aftermarket heater box that was put in the truck, and it's funny because the guy who owns this truck, the client, him and his dad actually put in a Ford heater box from like a 36, 38 Ford,
Speaking
which
of
was,
Ford, you have a question coming in.
Which is nothing more than, it was, remember those old, and I'm talking like Model A, Model T deals that were just like a small rectangular and almost pretty looking for a heater box, right? Like they were very small. They had a little flap door on them you would just pull up, and it was nothing more than a heater core that looped heat through on both sides, and that was it. Had two tubes that came off for just your pressure and return. that was actually mounted on the right side of the dash on here, and it had, you know, the Ford script on it, even though this is a 54 Chevrolet. So the client actually wanted to retain that piece because that was something that him and his dad did. So he wanted it in there, even though it was from a random Ford. So all of the holes on this firewall, we've completely welded up and smoothed them in so that it is going to be a nice clean look when it's done. As you know, the build of this job was to be something that was very kind of period correct, almost like it was an offering from GM in 54 with a factory, you know, small block Chevrolet setup, you know, with a Turbohydro 700R4 automatic four-speed overdrive setup. So it's going to be a really nice setup when it's done. It's going to look super clean. We've already built the motor. It is a 350 motor. So it is going to be a very nice setup from GM Performance. We've done it in the true Chevrolet orange, what it should be, with the correct valve covers from that time period of what you would have gotten on a V8 setup. So it is going to be a really nice clean install when it's done. All of the fender wells, the inner fender well, the core support, the firewall will all be in the factory GM satin black. So it's going to look like it was kind of a production 54 V8.
That's the way you build. But Adrian Fleming out of Minnesota says, can you put a Ford 8 under this swap fairly easily?
Yeah, that's actually that's a really good question, man. So as I've mentioned many times before, one of the reasons that Code 504 goes with this S10 chassis is because of its flexibility. There is a lot of pieces, not only in terms of the S10 chassis, but also the and with the Chevrolet swap for the body, but also like 47 to 54, but also for Dodge and for, you know, Mopar based vehicles and some Ford based pickup trucks. They also have kits from Code 504. One of the most important things is with these S10 chassis, if you are an S10 guy out there, if you know a little bit about them, there is incredible amount of things you can buy for these things. Off the shelf, very easy to do, and they give you a lot of added pros, man. There is, you know, factory disc brakes on them, you have factory power steering. They were originally typically fitted with a 4.3, the V6, with some sort of like four-speed automatic transmission setup, some of them 700R4, some 4L60s, which were either, you know, cable operated or electronically operated. Both great setups, and if you got your hands on the right piece, you could literally expand this thing as far as you wanted to go. So to do a, you know, V8 conversion, to do, you know, four-speed automatic, you can lay down 400, 500 horsepower in these things with no problem at all. Just on like the factory GM 10 bolt, if you wanted to, you can buy, you know, a posi traction setup. We typically do a lot with Eaton here at the shop. Yes. So you can literally pull out the whole setup, put in something capable of 400, 450, and have a really fun street strip cruiser, driver, every day, whatever you want to do with it. But if you do, because this is an S10, again, you want to change that out and you want to go deeper because of the S10 model line and the chassis. There are plenty of companies out there that do, like Mosier, for example, Mosier rear axles. They do actually sell complete Ford 8.8 and 9-inch rears that will bolt directly into an S10 setup. They've already got the S10 with leaf spring mounts on them. So you've got your perches there. You can literally buy these things either unloaded or loaded with the center section in it, and you can bolt it in and really lay down some serious horsepower if that's the style rear you want.
So you can run a small block Ford motor in this and take it all the way back to the rear.
Yep.
But if you're running a small block Ford engine in this, motor in this, will you be able to marry that to, say, a 4L60E or 700R4 if you're staying with the GM rear? Or, and how does that affect drive shaft lengths? Or do you want to just stay with Ford drivetrain all the way back at that point?
Well, no, this would be, so on this setup, this is going to be Chevrolet based, right? So this platform, Chevrolet based, being that is the Chevrolet C3100. If you did the Ford style conversion, yes, you can also do that with SBF, small block Ford style mounts and a transmission. Typically, you're not going to go from like and a lot of guys do this still out there, but there are a lot of guys that'll go from a Ford to sometimes a two-speed GM style transmission on like the track world. But there are a lot of guys that like to keep everything matched. So if you really wanted to do it properly, for example, if you were doing a Ford-based truck, nice small block Ford 289 302. A lot of guys even do the 302s with a 347 conversion, which is a stroker motor. And you can do that going into like an AOD transmission, which is the equivalent of, you know, GM's automatic overdrive transmission. So you can build a really fun street strip cruiser, something that's got great power, great reliability, and even decent fuel economy, upwards of, you know, 17, 18, you know, even going north of that. Miles per gallon, if you're just doing something, even, you know, depending on your budget, maybe even going to like a nice fuel injection setup, something easy, just a single pressure lineup, a 9-pound system, nothing crazy, nothing over the top, but a nice self-tuning, self-learning, advanced, easy EFI kit.
Is there really a big difference, Bub, between the Ford 9-inch rear ends and the Chrysler 7 3/4 or 9-inch rear ends and then 10 and 12 bolt Chevys? I mean, is there really that?
Yeah, you know, there's that's always been something that's gone back and forth in the car world for ages, man. And it's, you know, a lot of guys guys took and put Ford 9s in everything. You know, they were super, super strong axles from the factory. That's kind of what made them that name. They weren't blowing up out of the gate where GMs, the 10 bolts, the 12 bolts, yeah, they were strong, but there was a lot of issues with them. You know, a lot of guys love the Ford 9 because of how easy it is to work on. You can pull that center section out and you can build it on a bench, or you can have three center sections ready to go, depending on your lifestyle and your driving style, that are their shim, their backlash, they're ready to go. You can literally jack up the car if you're doing it even on your back. You can slide under, pull your axles out, pull the center out and put a new one in, and you're done within, you know, a couple hours. Where the GM style, you're having to take it apart, rebuild it, you've got to backlash it every time just to do a ring and pinion swap. So there's a lot of different pros and cons in terms of axles and what it is you want to run. But if you are doing something that's just like a one-time build, you want to lay down some raw power, for example, like this, you could easily get away with just rebuilding a complete GM 10 bolt. Or depending on your horsepower rating, go up to a 12 bolt style. Sure. Again, still direct fit for these S10 swaps, and you can build something strong.
Right on, Bub. So this is gonna stay all Chevrolet based.
Yeah, this will be all Chevrolet.
And Adrian out there in Minnesota, thank you for the question. I hope that answers it. You're getting it from one of the top three in the world.
And that's even what makes it nice, man. It's, you know, again, because you are working with an S10 chassis, there's so much that's available for them. If you wanted to, for example, say order in a four-wheel disc brake kit for your chassis, it's sure. not yeah. hard. You're not picking up the phone and trying to source a bunch of random parts, going to a junkyard to find these spindles and try to find this rotor and this inner wheel bearing and then this outer wheel bearing and then correct. This seal. That happens a lot in like the custom car modified street rod world. But if you work with something like this, you can pick up the phone and you can literally call and just get a very easy disc brake conversion kit for $400 for the back of an S10 chassis from 82 to 04, and it's literally 10 bolt, ready to go. You bolt it on, you hook up your lines, you bleed the brakes, and you're done.
And again, BEM and Code 504 bringing you the technology so that you have a very, very reliable driver. A car will still make it out to California back.
Oh, for sure, yeah, all day long. Right. As long as it's done right and you match the products up.
Right.
Don't put an 850 CFM carb on a 283 producing 200 horsepower.
Why you can't, and then keep putting cooling system components on it. But 9 times out of 100, when a car is overheating and it's a carbureted application, where is the problem found?
Typically in air fuel. Yeah, a lot of time is air fuel and ignition. It's you see that a lot, man. You see a lot of guys that have, you know, overheating issues, especially here in South Florida. Overheating, overheating, overheating. It's 85, 90 degrees out right now. Yep. A lot of the rest of the world's under a couple feet of snow. So it's pretty hot here in South Florida, and you see it a lot where guys are overheating on the side of the road. They've got $4,000 custom polished, show polished, B-Cool radiators in there with twin fans on it, and the things are screaming, but it's still overheating, right? And I'm just like, man, listen, I'm telling you, you need to address what your real issue is. It's not your cooling side. You've got flow, you've got air, you're good there. You need to look at the air fuel ignition side. A lot of guys have the timing way off, have the wrong plugs in it, have the wrong ignition going, have too much fuel dumping into it, too much fuel, too little fuel. You've got to make sure you're right on the money in terms of your tune. And that's why it's so expensive to have cars professionally tuned in today's high-end world. You're looking at $750 to do a basic tune.
And Bob, kind of the analogy that we use here at BEM is, imagine you've got a barbecue going and you've got a flame lit.
I don't know if I've heard this one, so just go.
The what?
I haven't heard this one, so go.
It's the one we talk about with our clients all the time. If you have a barbecue going, you've got a flame going, what happens if you take charcoal lighter and dump more charcoal lighter or gasoline on that fire?
You get more heat.
Get more heat, you get more explosion.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what we find. People run carburetors that are improper. You know, these Edelbrock intakes and the Holley carburetors, a lot of people have done it. It's not matched.
Yeah.
It's not how you build. Everything has to be matched. Everything has to be perfect.
I think that there's a reason for that. You know, there's a lot of guys that do swap meets, especially these older things, the budget builds. You know, there's one thing to do, you know, kind of these rat rod builds where, hey man, if you want to have something that barely makes it 5-10 miles and it's a miserable trip every time, then that's fine. But if you want something that's just turnkey reliable, get an electric choke setup. You know, even here in South Florida, you still have cold mornings, you get an electric choke setup. Very, very simple to deal with. You set it, you follow the instructions key to what Edelbrock says, float height, float drop, how to adjust the air fuel mixture screws on the front of them. And a lot of people screw that up. They think like one side is for fuel, the other side's for air. It's not. They are both for fuel mixture at idle. And those are all key items, man. And it's even down to, you know, where you hook up your distributor vacuum advance. A lot of people hook it up to the wrong place.
Yep.
You're pulling vacuum from a full-time port, not a ported port. And a lot of people really screw that up. So it's always key to just take the time, even though you've got a thick stack of instructions that come with it, or maybe even a DVD, stick it in, learn about it, follow the steps, and you'll probably have something night and day difference.
Is a porta port like a porta potty any or anything?
Really close, yeah.
Very close?
Yeah.
Okay, you can just pee on either one.
Whichever one you want, dude.
Doesn't matter,
yeah,
right?
That's
how
it.
About that? Adrian, thanks for the question. I hope that gives you a little more insight into your build. We'd certainly like to know more about your build. We will be doing another BEM Code 504 final update on Friday, Bub, with the vehicle fully assembled here,
yeah,
as well. And then we'll be finalizing that on Saturday's podcast, the number one rated internationally syndicated motorsports podcast. I believe that's the last time we'll be heard on Blog Talk Radio, Bub, as we're moving over to Podcast One, the new podcast platform.
That's it.
Pretty positive thing. Bub, and I want to remind everybody to come out on April 14th. Tell everybody where we'll be at April 14th.
Right? So we will be in Orlando with the guys, the world famous Paul Sr., Paul Jr., Mikey Tuttle. Everybody will be out there, yes, from American Choppers OCC. Yep. That will be out in Orlando. That is on what, the 14th, 2 p.m.
Yep.
For the GTO bike unveil. This thing is incredible. It's for the Make-A-Wish Foundation, so you guys won't want to miss it if you are local here in South Florida. If you aren't,
fly in.
Might be worth flying in. This, yeah, is going to be pretty epic.
Big. This one's big.
So it's at a great event, great setup. We will be posting that up online for you guys to be able to get access to that venue later on this week. So you'll see it. Stay tuned for that.
We are taking the BEM tour bus up, Bub. We're going to have a good time with that. I think Kenny's going to be the driver on this leg of the tour. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Yep.
Hopefully we'll get there in one piece.
No, I'm probably just going to drive my car.
Are you?
Yes.
You did just fix my Porsche. I mean, it could be driven up there, right?
Yeah.
Think it'll make it?
Nope.
Before we even get off the parking lot?
No.
You did spend this morning just taking care of mine.
I did.
Something happened to the back light.
I guess so, man.
So ladies and gentlemen, please join us in Orlando, Florida. Meet us in person. Meet the Tuttles in person. Good people. April 14th at 2 p.m. is the unveil at the Celebration Exotic Cars, I think they,
yep,
call it, Bub, or something like that.
Yep.
Something like that. It's going to be a lot of fun. Friday show will be the wrap up on this. Saturday we'll be doing the final talk about the project, Bub, on the show Friday and Saturday.
I got a lot of work to do. I got to get out.
We really do.
Yep.
Ladies and gentlemen, until Friday, Bub, what are we going to do
just
here?
Just keep on doing it, Bubba style.
This episode
has been brought to you by Bubba's Exotic Motorsports, ladies and gentlemen. That's bubbasexoticmotorsports.com. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what Bub does on the background.
Bro, you went through the entire show with no microphone.
Sort of like you're doing right now.
I'm good.
How about that, ladies and gentlemen? What about that, huh?
Where are you facing the camera now?
Larry Williams says, it's sound, it's Tom. And where's the camera going, Larry? And you know what? That's part of it, Larry. That's all the fun of doing a live show. It's fun! BubbasExoticMotorsports.com, ladies and gentlemen. That's BubbasExoticMotorsports.com. Tom did not turn on his mic pack today, and Bub's loving it. And you got to see him behind the scenes just kind of laughing about it, right?
Kenrick's going to love the fact that he has to adjust all the audio now. You might as well just scrap this show, bro. I'm just going to push delete here in a second.
No, no, Bub. Everybody got
just
to hear you
up.
Talking.
Stay
that was a technical
Friday.
Party, and I was coming off of your mic anyways.
Yeah.
It's only when you walked away, Bub, and shut off your mic that there was no sound. Did you notice that?
Yeah, I wonder why.
Larry, how hard are you laughing right now, sitting back in your chair going, Jesus Christ and General Jackson, those two.
Can you just wrap it up, dude?
Right?
We got to go.
How about that? How about that? Code 504, ladies and gentlemen, for the best in S10 conversions, Bub's personal seal of approval. If he didn't like it, he wouldn't do it, ladies and gentlemen. We'll see a wrap-up on this vehicle there on Friday. Let's make sure we reach out to touch somebody's life in a very positive manner today. Let's turn on your microphones when you're live on TV. Let's open the door for somebody who's got their hands full. It's too funny because Bub's over there laughing, Larry, right off the set there, right? How about that? Let's shoot somebody who's got holes in the bottom
ridiculous.
Of their
shoes. This is like a daily occurrence, I swear. And I give you 45 minutes to get ready for this show every day.
What did I do? What did I do Friday? Anything?
Nothing. Absolutely nothing.
I did nothing. I did something funny.
Larry Williams, come get this guy.
Stuff me in one of those challengers, Larry. How about that, ladies and gentlemen? 20 million of you around the world, and you get to see it live right here at Bubba's Exotic Motorsports. And let's make sure we feed somebody who's hungry, ladies and gentlemen, today. Power bar right there. Protein drink. It's all right there. It's less than your designer cup of coffee, ladies and gentlemen. Let's make sure we do it. Little man says he's ready to go eat until tomorrow, Friday, ladies and gentlemen. Let's make sure we do it. What, Bubba?
You might want to clear that up. You said until tomorrow, comma,
Friday. I said until Friday.
You said tomorrow, comma, Friday, like it's tomorrow. Today's not Thursday, it's Monday. So until Friday.
Until Friday, comma. No, wait. Until Friday, comma, ladies and gentlemen. Let's keep on.
Great episode, bro. It's a great episode.
Is your mic open, Bub?
It's on.
Yeah. See, Bub thinks it's a great episode, too. He's back in the producer's deck because, but see, if Kenrick was here today and not in Jamaica, our producer, we wouldn't have had this problem.
He's going to come back with dreads.
He's going to come back with dreads? Yeah. Kenrick's going to come back with dreads, Larry. How about that? Until Friday, ladies and gentlemen, let's keep on doing it. Bubba style.